Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Ūcuḥ striyaḥ pathi nirīkṣya mukunda-patnīs. Tārā yathoḍupa-sahāḥ akāry yathcakṣuṣām puruṣa-maulir uḍāra-hāsa. Līlāvaloka-kalayotsavam ātanoti. Ūcuḥ striyaḥ pathi nirīkṣya mukunda-patnīs. Tārā yathoḍupa-sahāḥ akāry cakṣuṣām puruṣa-maulir udāra-hāsa. Līlāvaloka-kalayotsavam ātanoti. Ūcuḥ striyaḥ pathi nirīkṣya mukunda-patnīs. Tārā yathoḍupa-sahāḥ akāry cakṣuṣām puruṣa-maulir udāra-hāsa. Līlāvaloka-kalayotsavam ātanoti.
Ladies, tārā yathoḍupa-sahāḥ,
cakṣuṣām
puruṣa-maulir, udāra-hāsa līlāvaloka-kalayotsavam ātanoti
ūcuḥ.
Said
striyaḥ,
the women,
pathi,
upon the road,
nirīkṣya,
sing,
mukunda,
of Lord Kṛṣṇa,
patni,
the wives,
tārā,
stars,
yathā,
light.
Udu-pa,
the
moon,
saha,
accompanying,
kim,
what
akāry
was done,
amūbhiḥ,
by them,
yat,
since,
cakṣuṣām,
for their eyes,
puruṣa,
of men,
mauliḥ,
the diadem,
udāra,
wide,
hāsa,
with smiles,
līlā,
playful,
avaloka,
of his glances,
kalayā,
with a small portion,
utsavam,
a festival,
ātanoti,
he bestows.
Observing Lord Mukunda's wives passing on the road like stars accompanying the moon, the women exclaimed, "What have these ladies done so that the best of men bestows upon their eyes the joy of his generous smile and playful sidelong glances?" In various places, citizens of the city came forward holding auspicious offerings for Lord Kṛṣṇa, and sinless leaders of occupational guilds came forward to worship the Lord. Purport. Srila Prabhupada writes, "While Lord Kṛṣṇa was thus passing on the road, at intervals some of the opulent citizens, who were all rich, respectful, and freed from sinful activities, presented auspicious articles to the Lord, just to offer him a reception to the city. Thus they worshipped him as humble servitors."
Om Agyantimidandasya Jnananjana Chalakaya Chakshuru Nilidamjina Tasmai Sri Gurave Namaha Sri Chaitanya Manobhishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Svapadantikam Andeham Sri Guru, Sri Jutha Patakamalam, Sri Guru Vaishnavamscha, Sri Rupam Sagrajataham, Sahagana Raghunatham Vidham, Tam Sajivam, Sadvaitam, Savadutam, Parijana Sahitam, Krishna Chaitanya Devam, Sri Radha Krishna Padam Sahakana Lalita Sri Vishakam Vitamscha He Krishna Karuna Sindhu Dina Bandhu Chakatpate Kopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostate Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vansha Kalpatarubhyascha Kripasindubhya Evacha Patithanam Bhavanibhyo Vaishnavibhyo Namo Namaha Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadadhar Shivasati Gaura Bhakta Brinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama 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 Hare Hare
In various places, citizens of the city came forward, holding auspicious offerings for Lord Kṛṣṇa. And sinless leaders of occupational guilds came forward to worship the Lord. We are reading from Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 10, Chapter 71. Entitled The Lord Travels to Indraprastha. Text 36 and 37. As we discussed yesterday, when Lord Kṛṣṇa entered Indraprastha, the king, Yudhisthira Maharaj, came off of his throne with his own enthusiasm. He went to the outskirts of the city to welcome Lord Kṛṣṇa. And with tears of love, he embraced Kṛṣṇa. And Kṛṣṇa embraced him. And similarly, Arjuna, Bhima, Nakula, Sahadev were weeping, limbs trembling, as they exchanged loving embraces with Lord Kṛṣṇa. And we read yesterday how the ladies of Indraprastha, they went to their rooftops where they saw the whole city having a great utsav, a great festival to welcome Kṛṣṇa. They were showering flowers upon him. They were singing his glories. The ladies, each and every one of them, through their glances and smiles, were offering their bodies, their minds, their words, their hearts, their souls to Kṛṣṇa. And Kṛṣṇa was reciprocating through his glances and smiles. He was accepting and giving his very self to them within their own hearts. Today's verses, we find every different type of citizen of Indraprastha was having the same beautiful relation of reciprocation, of affection with Kṛṣṇa. Whether they were the leaders of the occupational guilds, every type of citizen, they were completely united in one spirit. to celebrate Krishna's arrival. And the concept of Varnashram Dharma from a Vaishnav perspective is very much illustrated in this. Atapumbirdvijastreshtas Varnashrama Vibhagasha Shvanushtutasya Dharmasya Samsadhyar Haritoshana. Whatever our Varna or Ashram, whatever our occupation, or our particular status in society, our only purpose is truly to give pleasure to Krishna, to serve Krishna. And that is the true unity of humanity. When we have a common purpose, not based on fear, not based on the troubles that we will all endure if we do not unite, not based on some political alliance to help each other, to defend ourselves from some other enemy. There are so many ways people become united. Some become united because if we're united, we all make more money. We all become more powerful. Their unity is on this spiritual platform. Whatever differences, we are all eternally Krishna's servants. And what will please Krishna is the only success of our life. So in this way, with one heart, the whole Indraprastha welcomed Krishna. And Krishna was so pleased. He describes in today's verse that they were so happy to see the good fortune of Krishna's queens. Every lady in Indraprastha would be so honored to be Krishna's queen. We have read in the previous chapter how Krishna reciprocated with each and every one of his queens. There were 16,108. And Narada Muni came to visit Krishna to see how he's living in this way. He's already created this island called Dwarka, and now he's living there. So he went to one palace of Rukmini, and Krishna was sitting on a little seat, very beautiful seat, with Rukmini and all of her associates around. And Krishna got up and offered his respects to Narada and put Narada on his own seat and washed his feet. And Rukmini Devi was fanning Narada Muni. They're living in a beautiful palace, most beautiful palace in all of creation. And Narada Muni is homeless. I don't think there's any scripture that I know of, Radhe Shyam may know, but I don't know of any scripture that talks about Narada Muni's house. And what kind of furniture he may have had. He's always traveling. I never even heard of him going to sleep, actually. Where does he sleep? He's just always going somewhere to chant Krishna's names and give Krishna to someone. Whether it's a king, or whether it's a hunter, or whether it's a dacoit, or whether it's a business person, or whether it's Krishna. He's going everywhere, giving bhakti, devotional service. So here is this homeless sadhu, and the goddess of fortune, Rukmini Devi, is rendering personal service to him. Now, for most people, if the goddess of fortune was offering you chamara and willing to give you any benediction, you may be tempted to ask for something. But in Narada Muni's case, Krishna and Rukmini were asking Narada Muni for blessings because they wanted to show he has real wealth. He has compassion for everyone. That compassion is an expression of his love for Krishna. Narada Muni went to so many different palaces. And in each palace, Krishna was there. And in each palace, Krishna was doing something completely different, with different queens, with different children, with different friends. And he spent so much of the day going palace after palace after palace, seeing. And in every palace, when Krishna saw Narada Muni coming, it was as if he hadn't seen Narada Muni for such a long time. He came running, Narada Muni, you are so merciful, so kind, you have come to bless my palace. It's not that he said, I just saw you a few minutes ago in my other palace. He wasn't, every form of Krishna was the same exact Krishna, but revealing his opulences. In each palace, Krishna was so surprised that Narada Muni came. And so eager to see him after so long. He served him with his queens and his family. And then when it came for Krishna to go to Sudharma, the assembly house of Dwarka, Narada Muni saw Krishna depart from each palace. And at the doorway of each palace, each particular queen was saying goodbye to him and was smiling, but in their hearts they were crying because of separation all day from Krishna, and all the children of Krishna were saying goodbye to the father, and all the associates of the palace were in ecstasy of love and imminent separation from Krishna all day, saying goodbye to Krishna. And Narada Muni is watching this. Krishna is uniquely speaking each person's name and reciprocating and according to their particular natures. And then Krishna goes on his chariot, and all 16,108 forms of Krishna become one. And he comes to Sudharma, and he sits on his throne. And Narada Muni sees how everyone in Sudharma, all these great rulers and leaders, are honoring Krishna, and how Krishna is honoring all of them. And what's leading to today's story of today's verses is one time Shukadeva Goswami tells, as Krishna was sitting on his Paramasana, that means his supremely beautiful throne, this person entered the assembly. Nobody knew who he was. Nobody ever saw him before. But Krishna was so magnanimous, he didn't have an appointment. You know, if you want to see a political head of a state today, you have to go through so much bureaucracy to get an appointment. But he was just, nobody knew who he was, where he was coming from, but he wanted to see Krishna. So he was very lovingly escorted right to Krishna's throne. Krishna was open for everyone. And he came with a message. He spoke about the kingdom of Giribraj in the Magadha province, where he had just come from. There were 20,000 kings who were imprisoned by Jarasandha. Jarasandha was so powerful. Of all the demons, he was really powerful. Just his own physical body had the strength of 10,000 elephants. Try to understand what this means. And these are Dwapara Yuga elephants, which are probably at least 1,000 times stronger than Kali Yuga elephants. 10,000 elephants. That means hundreds and thousands of elephants as we know them. That was his physical strength. Last night I went to Radhikapati Prabhu and his family, Krishna Chani Prabhu, to their, I don't remember the name of it, Govinda Prabhu knows, he's, I don't think he goes there for any other reason than to bless, give blessings, but it's some sort of fitness factory where people become physically strong. Can you imagine if Jarasandha came there? He could lift the whole building up in a second. He had powerful mystic cities. And not only was he physically powerful, but he was so influential that any time he wanted to attack someone, he could get thousands of kings and hundreds and thousands of soldiers to give their lives for him. Not out of love, but out of fear. Jarasandha was so powerful. You know who one of his students was? Kamsa. Kamsa was one of Jarasandha's favorite students. So much so that he gave his two beloved daughters to Kamsa to marry. So in this way, to be the son-in-law is a very subordinate position. So we read about Kamsa, how atrocious and how demoniac he was. But being a student of Jarasandha means he got a lot of those evil propensities from Jarasandha. He was so arrogant, so evil, so cruel. But at the same time, he was, in his own demoniac way, he was extremely intelligent. He knew that to get his powers and keep his powers, he had to honor the Brahminical culture. He didn't follow the teachings of Brahmins, but he gave worship and honor to them. Just as Hiranyakashipu did in his own way. So, this messenger was telling how these 20,000 kings were all prisoners because Jarasandha was conquering all directions. And when he or his soldiers went to any kingdom, they demanded total surrender. Give us your complete allegiance. Whatever property you own is now under Jarasandha's jurisdiction. You pay him what he wants you to pay. In other words, they could be kings of their provinces as long as they were his slaves, in a sense. So most people would surrender to him, because it's either surrender or die. Because it was well known that Charasandha was a devotee of Mahabhairava, a form of Shiva. And he had decided that for the pleasure of Mahabhairava, the great destroyer, he would perform 100,000 human sacrifices of kings of the earth by severing their heads and offering them in the sacred fire. So when somebody of that power and that reputation comes to your kingdom and says surrender, if you don't surrender, then your head's going to be put in the fire. But they didn't surrender. So there were 20,000 kings in the prison, just waiting for their death. And they sent this message to Kṛṣṇa, that you have descended into this world because you are so merciful. In your form of time, you destroy everything. And now we are in this helpless condition. We cannot fight against Charasandha. All of us together do not equal him. We are helpless. Please protect us. You are our only hope. The kings were completely taking shelter of Kṛṣṇa. The messenger said that, Kṛṣṇa, you defeated Charasandha 17 times. But on the 18th time, by your own pastimes of appearing like a human, you ran away. And in Kshatriya way of thinking, to run away from battle is a far greater defeat than being killed. If you're killed on the battlefield, it's considered heroic. But if you run away, it's considered the worst defeat. You're a coward. So when Kṛṣṇa ran away from Charasandha as Ranchor, we glorify Kṛṣṇa for that. But Charasandha he was so under the illusion to his false ego, his arrogance, his false pride inflated uncontrollably. I defeated Kṛṣṇa. And now he was really causing havoc, because he felt nothing and no one could ever stop him. So the kings were giving this appeal. And the messenger, he told Kṛṣṇa, they are asking, please, please save us. The king said that we know that only people who are really foolish and under illusion due to their past sinful activities, they think that they can be enjoyers of this world, not knowing that the only happiness for the soul is in loving you and serving you. And then they said, and we, these dead corpses that we live in called the bodies, we are so foolish that we're thinking that we can enjoy because we're kings
And in this way, trying to enjoy our kingly comforts and luxuries and happiness, we have forgotten the real pleasure of the soul, the only pleasure of the soul, which is loving service to you. The kings, many of them obviously were very pious people, but even pious people become distracted by their material responsibilities, their material circumstances, by materialistic people around them, whether they're sinful people or even pious people. The material world is full of distractions. But here the kings were now, everything was taken away from them. Krishna tells Narada Muni, and Maharaj Yudhisthira, he tells Yudhisthira Maharaj this verse. When the king asked Krishna, why did you take everything away from the Pandavas? And why did you cast us into the forest for so many years in exile, putting us in a situation where for 12 years Duryodhana was disgracing us? And Krishna spoke this verse. When I give my greatest mercy, I take everything away from my devotee. So that devotee has nothing and no one to turn to except me. Krishna spoke that to Yudhisthira. And Yudhisthira's mother, Kunti Devi, she echoed the same principle when she spoke akinchana gocharam. Krishna, you are the property of those who are bereft of everything. Akinchana doesn't mean we don't have anything. It means we understand Krishna is our only shelter. And we understand everything belongs to him. Nothing is mine. My beauty, my strength, my intelligence, my wealth, my property, my family, my home. Everything belongs to you, Krishna. Manaso deho geho jo kichamur. Arpilun tu alpadi nanda kisho. Yudhisthira was a king. Kunti was the mother of the king. Bhaktivinoda Thakur was a magistrate, a householder, Paramhamsa. They all had the same spirit, as does Narada Muni and Raghunath Das Goswami. Whether we're sannyasis or babajis, or whether we're brahmacharis, or business engineers, farmers, housewives, students, surrender is this spirit. Everything belongs to Krishna. And in this sense, we really take shelter of Krishna. Because when we're no longer distracted by the arrogance, the ego of I and mine, then we can actually be receptive to the reality of this material world. Everything's temporary. By the power of time, everything is being taken away. Everything will be taken away. It's so obvious. But when we become distracted by material attractions and aversions, we just don't really feel it. We don't really experience it. And understanding is not just an intellectual conceptualization. To actually know is realization. It's an experience. We see how time is consuming everything and everyone. We see how Maya Devi is working.
And if we actually understand the material world as it is, Brahma bhuvana loka punar avatanorjana mamupeti tukontiya punar janmana vidyate, then in whatever situation we're in, we will helplessly take shelter of Kṛṣṇa. In victory or defeat, honor or dishonor, happiness or distress, health or disease, success or failure, whatever situation we're in, we see how material and nature works. And we understand, and the eternal soul. But in this world, I'm so forgetful, and I'm so vulnerable, whoever I am. And we take shelter. King Yudhisthira was enlightened. He took shelter when he had nothing in the forest, and he took shelter exactly in the same way when he was the king of the world. Because he understood that everything is Kṛṣṇa's. He could see the material world for what it was. So these kings were very fortunate. They were in the prison of Jarasandha. It was a reality. They weren't just reading something in a book. They were seeing Jarasandha every day, face to face, Jarasandha, with all his cruelty. They were seeing his human sacrifices, knowing that they were going to be next. They had nowhere to go, nowhere to run, nowhere to hide, nothing. They were really taking shelter of Kṛṣṇa. And they sent their message. And Kṛṣṇa could feel their hearts. And meanwhile, the Yadu dynasty, they were listening to this message of the cruelties and the arrogance and the demoniac nature of Jarasandha. And the Yadu dynasty knew that Jarasandha, with hundreds and thousands of soldiers, attacked to kill Kṛṣṇa 17 times. He was angry. His deepest attachment was to his two daughters. And they came back from Mathura weeping and crying hysterically. Now they're young women and they're widows. And they put all the blame on Kṛṣṇa. Our husband was so good. He was protecting us. He was such a great man. And this Kṛṣṇa, those widowed daughters were really blaspheming Kṛṣṇa. And seeing how much pain Kṛṣṇa gave to his daughters, and how Kṛṣṇa killed his best friend, favorite student, and strongest ally, Kamsa, Jarasandha, his mind went totally wild with revenge. He had to kill Kṛṣṇa. He could find no peace of mind, anything, unless he avenged the death of his son-in-law. And he was so completely mad with this desire for revenge, which is born of envy and hate. And even though Kṛṣṇa destroyed all his armies 17 times, captured him, left him in a helpless condition, and then humiliated him by letting him go. And the reason he let him go, because Kṛṣṇa came, paritranaya sadhunam vinashaya chatuskrita. He came to annihilate the miscreants. Bhumi Devi, Mother Earth, in the form of a cow, came to Brahma, and Brahma brought Shiva and all the demigods to the ocean of milk to pray to Vishnu to save them. Because Mother Earth was being trampled on by people like Jarasandha and Shishupal
and kamsa. She was praying. All the demigods were praying. So, Jarasandha, he was so blinded by his hate, by his envy, that he couldn't see that Kṛṣṇa was making a complete fool out of him. And Kṛṣṇa kept letting him go so he would bring millions of more kings for Kṛṣṇa to annihilate. Like Śrīla Prabhupāda said, if you have a really nice community, then people will come to you. Yes? Just like Sri Mayapur Dham, by Śrīla Prabhupāda's very, very deep desire, he wanted his followers to create the temple of the Vedic planetarium. Because through building this beautiful temple, Śrīla Prabhupāda gave some basic designs, he gave some basic dimensions, and he personally, before he left this world, he laid the cornerstone, Anantashesha. It was quite obvious it wasn't going to happen in his lifetime, but he did that to make sure we took it serious that it does happen. Now, Sri Mayapur Dham, at the time Prabhupada did that, was a very isolated place. Just paddy fields and a few Gaudiya Math temples and some villagers. Most of the villagers were not even devotees or even Hindus. But if we build this temple, then millions and millions of people from all over the world will come to associate with devotees, to understand the purity of Lord Chaitanya's message, to feel the mercy of the Dham of Sri Mayapur. So similarly, Kṛṣṇa could go out to each of these kingdoms. But through Jarasandha, all the kings were coming right to him in Dwarka.
Hare Krishna.
So the Yadus, they were really enthusiastic. They were angry. They were on fire to go with all their armies and squash this Jarasandha once and for all. After all, he was, besides his cruelty to all these kings, he was so blasphemous of Kṛṣṇa, they couldn't tolerate it. So there was excitement in the Sudama assembly hall. The Yadus were ready to attack. Then Narada Muni came in. And Kṛṣṇa, in front of everyone, he was so jubilant to see Narada Muni. He offered Narada Muni a very nice seat. He worshipped Narada Muni. And then Kṛṣṇa asked Narada Muni, how are the Pandavas? Narada Muni explained how Maharaj Yudhisthira wants to perform the supreme of all sacrifices, or yajñas, called the Raja Surya. And he wants to perform this Raja Surya yajña for one reason. You see, in order to perform this particular ceremony, you have to, every king in the world has to accept your superior position and accept themselves
subordinate. Maharaj Yudhisthira had all opulences. There was nothing materially that he didn't have that he could want. But he had one desire. He wanted Krishna to be recognized and glorified as the Supreme Personality of Godhead, as the ultimate worshipable object for all creation. So Yudhisthira Maharaj wanted to perform the Rajasuya Yajna. And Krishna, he really wants you to come. So Narada Muni was very much excited that Krishna go to Indraprastha. The Yadus were very much excited for Krishna to go and fight Jarasandha. So there was a serious disagreement here. They weren't fighting. Doesn't discuss in the Bhagavatam that there was arguments, but they very much had their own ideas of how best to serve. And Krishna was between both of them. So Krishna appeared to be confused by his own lila, and he turned to Uddhava. And he said, Uddhava, there are two very, very strong opinions here telling me to go to different places. Now, if Krishna wanted to, he could have expanded himself and done both. Every day he expands himself into 16,108 forms. When he went to Mithila, Bahulaswa invited him, please come to my palace. And Shrutadev said, please come to my straw hut. Krishna just went both at the same time to make everyone happy. So Krishna could have done. But Krishna wants to glorify his devotee. So he appeared to be needing help. And he turned to his dearmost friend, Uddhava, and said, Uddhava, you are like my eyes, and you are filled with wisdom and intelligence. And you know the art of giving good counsel, advice. So please tell me what I should do. Uddhava expressed, after hearing both sides, for the pleasure, and seeing how Krishna wanted to please everyone, because they were all his devotees. But there's a difference between how warriors like the Yadus think and how sages like Narada Muni think. They have two different kinds of mindsets. But what they have in common is they're completely surrendered with pure unalloyed devotion for Krishna's pleasure. Unity and diversity. This concept of unity and diversity is very dynamic. Unless we really are in that mood for the pleasure of Krishna, it could create a lot of chaos. Because we are all thinking, we're naturally all thinking we're right. And we really believe it. And we have so much evidence. Because that's our nature. We have to kill Jarasandha. Now, let's take our armies. And Narada Muni saying, no, Maharaj Yudhisthira wants you to come for this ceremony. Bring your family, bring your friends. Have this wonderful ceremony. So Uddhava said that if you go to kill Jarasandha, then that will be an inseparable act to facilitate Yudhisthira Maharaja's Rajasuya. Because as long as Jarasandha doesn't surrender to Yudhisthira, Yudhisthira can't do the Rajasuya. And Uddhava gave Krishna the advice of how Jarasandha should be killed. He said he has the strength of 10,000 elephants. And there is not a single person in the Yadu dynasty who could kill him. Besides yourself, there's only one person who has the strength that's equal to Jarasandha, and that is Bhima. Now, Jarasandha has hundreds and thousands of soldiers around him, ready for battle. So it will be very difficult to defeat him with all of his armies. But I have a plan of how Bhima can fight him alone. He explained, disguise yourselves as Brahmins, because he's very faithful to the Brahminical culture. He's very afraid to offend the Brahmins. Go there to beg. And when you come to him as Brahmins, he must fulfill what you beg for. Beg him to fight with Bhima. Let Bhima beg for battle. And Uddhava said that Brahma and Shiva, they control the whole universe as instruments of your power. Under the almighty power of time, through Brahma and Shiva, you create and destroy everything. And in the same way, Bhima will be your instrument so that he will be glorified to kill Jarasandha. Uddhava expressed, at their homes, the wives of these kings who are in prison, they are singing your glories. And how Lord Sri Krishna will kill the enemies, the enemy of their husbands. The children of the kings, when they cry out in separation from their fathers, their mothers tell them, please do not worry. Krishna will kill the enemy of your fathers. That's the faith the wives had in Krishna. Not only were the husbands taking shelter of Krishna, but as much or more the wives were taking shelter of Krishna. And Uddhava said, similarly, the gopis, they are also singing your glories of how you kill the enemy of Gajendra, who is about to destroy him in the form of a crocodile. How you kill the enemy of Sita, Ravana, when she was helplessly his prisoner in Sri Lanka. How you kill the enemy of your own mother and father, Vasudeva and Devaki, when they were prisoners also. Kamsa. And all the great sages are singing your glories and taking shelter of you. And Narada Muni said, and even myself, ourselves, we're all taking shelter of you, Krishna. From this beautiful verse of Uddhava, we can understand in our own lives. Śrīla Prabhupāda and our acharyas
extracting the very essential message of all the scriptures have told us, that the mind, when it is controlled, it's our best friend. When it's not controlled, it's our worst enemy. In fact, Srimad Bhagavatam tells that actually there is no other enemy than our own uncontrolled mind. Krishna tells in Bhagavad Gita, for one who sees me everywhere and everything in me, for that person I'm never lost, nor is he ever lost to me. So when our mind is pure and clean, we see Krishna everywhere. We see the opportunity to serve Krishna everywhere. We see the hand of Krishna behind every situation. Even on cloudy day, we know the sun is behind the clouds. The clouds are just temporary covering. So for a devotee, in whatever situation they're in, they know that Krishna's with me. Krishna's in my heart. Krishna's with me, always there to give me shelter if I sincerely turn to him and call out his holy names. There's a beautiful verse in Srimad Bhagavatam that the mind, it is like a very dangerous wild animal that wants to kill you. And when you catch that, you have to keep very close guard over it, because if you're the slightest bit inattentive, it will attack you. Sorry. That wasn't me, that was my uncontrolled mind. So a devotee must be very careful to understand the power of the uncontrolled mind. And there are six enemies that occupy the kingdom of our mind. Kama, selfish, passionate lust. Krodha, anger. Bhagavad Gita teaches that when we contemplate the objects of the senses, we develop attachment for them. From such attachment, kama, lust develops. And when lust, when our selfish passions are unfulfilled, krodha, anger. And just as kama can completely capture our minds, capture our, and control our words and control our actions, similarly, anger can do the same. And greed, insatiable greed, where the mind, when it's captivated by greed, it pollutes the intelligence, and we think we have the right to cause so much pain and suffering to others just so that I can get more. And arrogance, the conception of the obsessive need to feel oneself superior to others. Envy. If someone else appears to have more than me, then I burn. I can't tolerate it. I have to somehow or other, either I have to destroy that obstacle in my mind by whatever means are required. Lust, anger, greed, arrogance, envy, and illusion. Where we forget that we are the eternal soul. And in that condition, we're so vulnerable to be distracted on this bodily and mental platform. So these are the six enemies. And actually, a conditioned soul is a prisoner of these enemies, who all together have taken captivity of our mind. And this uncontrolled mind filled with these six enemies is actually millions of times more powerful than Jarasandha. We read about the prowess of Jarasandha, but where is he getting his prowess from? Because he's captured by these six enemies. He's a slave. He who's enslaving everyone else, he's a slave of these six enemies. He's an instrument of arrogance and envy and lust and greed. So when we are under the captivity of these anarthas, more or less, in a real sense, we are all like those kings. The kings could do nothing against the power of Jarasandha, but they could live in a way that pleased Krishna. They were completely pious. They were completely good in all of their activities because they understood they couldn't be evil or arrogant or sinful and expect Krishna's mercy. They wanted to please Krishna. And at the same time, while living in harmony with Krishna's will, they were crying out for Krishna as their only shelter. And it is in this spirit that each and every one of us has hope, the only hope of not being subjugated by the enemy of the mind and the six enemies occupying the mind. We have to truly please Krishna. And as Prabhupada said, like a little baby is helplessly dependent on a mother, like these kings and the wives of the queens at home are completely dependent on the mercy of Krishna's grace. In that spirit, we chant the holy name. Baladev Prabhu gave us so many nice stories of the December book distribution marathon. Why are devotees so enthusiastic? Because we see the world, everyone is like those prisoners in Jarasandha's prison. The controller of Jarasandha, forgetfulness of Krishna, is so much occupying and subjugating the world. And we're trying to give them that message. Because people make friends with their enemies without knowing. And Bhagavad Gita, Srila Prabhupada's books, commentaries, are giving people an understanding that we are the eternal soul, we're not these temporary bodies. Everything does belong to Krishna. And Krishna is our true shelter. And Krishna has so mercifully appeared in this age of Kali, especially in his holy names and in the hearts of his loving devotees. So Uddhava made this proposal to Krishna. Go with Bhima,
have him disguise himself as a Brahmin, beg Jarasandha to fight. And because Bhima will be an instrument of your mercy, Krishna, you, through Bhima, will liberate the world from Jarasandha. And liberate Jarasandha, too. And then the doorway will be completely open to satisfy Narada Muni's desire to perform the Rajasuya. So all the senior members of the Yadu dynasty and Krishna and Narada Muni all rejoiced with the completely harmonious wisdom of Uddhava. He satisfied everyone. But Vishwanath Chakravarti Thakur explains some of the younger Yadus, they weren't so happy because they really wanted to fight with Jarasandha. But the senior ones were all really happy. And Krishna was really happy. And it was, you know, it was quite unanimous among all the seniors. Narada Muni, yes, this is what we will do. So then Krishna decided we will go to Indraprastha. The plan was he would go to Indraprastha, he would meet Yudhisthira Maharaj and the Pandavas, and then when Yudhisthira Maharaj and the Pandavas tell him that we have actually conquered everything except Jarasandha, then for the pleasure of Yudhisthira, Krishna will go with Bhima and Arjuna to meet with Jarasandha. Krishna called Daruka and another charioteer, and they arranged the chariots right away. And the queens had their palanquins, and Krishna's children, and soldiers, and the common people. It was a large group of people from Dwarka who were all going to go on a procession with Krishna to Indraprastha. And as Krishna was just preparing to go, Narada Muni bowed down to Krishna, and Krishna offered his respects to Narada Muni, and Narada Muni was completely happy. And then Krishna turned to the messenger of the kings, and he said, tell the kings and their wives that they have nothing to fear. I will kill Jarasandha. And he went back and he told the kings, and they had complete faith in Krishna's words. At that point, they were simply eagerly lolyam. Just this eagerness, intense eagerness to see Krishna. And in this spirit, they were glorifying Krishna, talking about Krishna. Their minds were completely filled only with Krishna as they chanted his holy names. Reading in these pages of Srimad Bhagavatam how these kings who have everything's taken away from them, they're in prison, they're about to die and be tortured, their wives are completely forsaken of everything, of hope for their future, and what will Jarasandha do to them after he kills their husbands? They're taking shelter of Krishna, eagerly awaiting his arrival. And in the same spirit, Indraprastha, they're free, they have all opulence and all wealth and all luxury. They have no problems. And in the same spirit, they are eagerly welcoming Krishna.
Maro birako bijo icha tuhar. Bhaktivinoda Thakur says, in whatever situation we're in, we take shelter of Krishna. So the contrast of these two situations that the devotees are in is very, very instructive to us. The citizens of Indraprastha, who are living in incredible material prosperity, are giving their hearts, their souls, with eagerness to welcome Krishna. And the kings who are living in prison, about to die materially, everything taken away, are in the same mood of eagerly anticipating the arrival of Krishna. And here at Sri Sri Radha Gopinath Temple, Krishna's here. But in one sense, even better, because he's in his Vrindavan mood. He's with Srimati Radharani, giving their darshan to us, giving their shelter to us, calling us into their eternal pastimes with the promise, if you just take shelter of me, as the servant of the servant of my servants, and chant my holy names, then he will kill all our enemies and give us eternal happiness in his eternal abode. So what we read in Srimad Bhagavatam, it's important we understand how this is a living scripture that's teaching us how to live today. But when we come before Radha Gopinath, do we have the eagerness and the gratitude? And do we understand the grace we're receiving, like the kings, the imprisoned kings, or the jubilant residents of Indraprastha? Yayata mam prapadyante tams tathaiva bhajamya. In whatever situation, Krishna will reciprocate according to our mood of surrender. So we come to the temple to surrender. Krishna, I'm yours. And in the association of so many devotees, when we share that experience, it's truly a festival. Thank you very much.
Hare Krishna, there are two nice announcements. Tuesday, 15 December, Maharaj will be giving a class at the Birla House. It's evening 7 p.m. So the passes can be collected through your respective counselors or mentors. And our devotees from Juhu,